Hi,
I'm Pete. I'm also a farmer. That's me. I grew up on the Fishers Island Oyster Farm. Fishers Island is a tiny island east of Long Island, about 100 miles from New York City. And we all grew up working on boats as farmhands, trying to grow enough oysters to keep a roof over our heads and food on the table. Back in the summer of 1995, I was 12 years old, and I was out on the boat with my older brother, Nick. He was 13, and we were hauling nets into the boat, just like these guys here. And we noticed that every time we pulled a net out of the water, there was a big splash underneath it. And so we looked, and we learned that there were actually these huge striped bass, big fish, that were coming in and eating the small fish that that swam out of the nets whenever we pulled them up. And some of those small fish also came into the boat with the nets. So Nick and I obviously tried to feed the striped bass, and we reached down and picked up these little cunners and juvenile blackfish from the bottom of the boat and held them over the side and waited. And sure enough, these huge striped bass crept slowly up and sucked the fish right out of our hands. So I'm not here to advocate for hand-feeding wildlife. But Nick and I at this time were both avid fishermen. We spent the majority of our free time trying to find striped bass. So to see so many of them at the farm was absolutely thrilling. And we both realized in that moment that we had made this little tiny piece of ocean a little bit better for those striped bass. And that's what this is all about. Positive emotional connections with the natural world and the understanding that we all have the power to make it better. The environmental movement, we've been trying to convince humans to change their behavior for 40 years. And a primary tool we've been using for that is the specter of doom, right? The idea that we have to make a lot of changes quick or all these bad things are going to happen. There's one thing that I've learned in my four decades is that doom and gloom is not an effective motivator for changing human behavior. I'm done with doom and gloom. It has no use to me. I'm here for hope, joy, and love of wild natural places. I don't want to spend my life trying to avoid negative outcomes. I want to spend my life trying to do something incredible, trying to change the relationship that people have with the natural world. And we can look back in time to understand how to do that. This is the New York Harbor that Europeans first found in the 1600s when they found it. New York Harbor is an estuary. Estuaries are characterized by rivers bringing nutrient-rich fresh water to the coast where it mixes with the ocean. Estuaries are the most productive ecosystems in the world. This estuary used to be, like many other estuaries, used to be full of oyster reefs. Oysters are a keystone species. They have a disproportionate positive impact on the organisms around them, just like the trees in a forest, the grass in a salt marsh, or corals in a coral reef system. For thousands of years, people thrived living around this estuary. The Lenape practiced honorable harvest, which meant that the land, plants, and animals were familial relations that required protection. And because of that honorable harvest, and because of the oyster reefs and the conditions in the estuary, Europeans found a harbor that was totally full of wild animals. They described not being able to see the sky for minutes at a time because there were so many birds, and being able to catch fish just by lowering a basket over the side of the boat and hauling it back up. They rode home to tell their friends, "We'll never need to go anywhere else for fish. There's more fish here than we could ever possibly eat." That, of course, was not true. And it took only about 100 years to eradicate the animals and destroy the ecosystem. And it started by harvesting most of the oysters off the bottom of the harbor and removing that landscape. And then we turned New York Harbor into our dumping ground and poured sewage, dead animals, trash, all kinds of horrible things into the water. The people started getting sick, and it came as a huge surprise to New Yorkers that pouring raw sewage on your food supply was a problem. And the last oyster bed was finally closed in the early 1900s. And then for the next 100 years, generations of New Yorkers lived with that condition, a growing city surrounded by waterways that smelled bad, looked gross, and were dangerous to touch. And it wasn't until the Clean Water Act passed in 1972 that things started to turn around. But they have turned around. And now we have New York City today, millions of people living around this incredible natural resource who are, for the most part, completely unaware of its existence. Most streets in New York end at the water's edge, but most New Yorkers don't identify as living on the water or living in a port city surrounded by this incredible natural resource. But the water quality has improved dramatically, so much that it can once again support all the animals that used to live there. And the animals are coming back, and they're coming back fast. But without the oyster reefs, all of those animals are starved for habitat. There's nowhere to hide and nothing to eat. So we created Billion Oyster Project to solve those two problems at the same time. Restore the habitat and reconnect New Yorkers to the water. 1 million people working together to restore 1 billion oysters. And that work started as a high school class project at the New York Harbor School, a public high school on Governor's Island where students are learning marine careers and practicing the skills associated with those careers by restoring oysters to the harbor. We've grown outside of Harbor School, and we now have partnerships with over 150 public schools, 80 restaurants, dozens of community groups, and thousands of volunteers. So far, 120,000 New Yorkers have taken time out of their busy lives to walk down into New York Harbor and helped us to restore oysters. Many of these people never would have considered that there are animals beneath the surface of the water in New York Harbor. All of them have now formed a positive emotional connection with the natural world in their backyard and learned through direct experience that they have the power to make it better. And it's working. So far, not me, but all of us have been able to restore 150 million live oysters to reefs all over the harbor. At all of those sites, we see an immediate and dramatic increase in the abundance and diversity of animals. It's incredibly exciting to put an oyster reef down somewhere where you don't see any living things and come back only a few weeks later and see it just crawling with life. The water quality in the harbor is the best it's ever been. We see wild oysters showing up in more places all around the harbor, and the animals are coming back. You heard about some of them earlier, but it's been so exciting over the last 15 years to watch this happen. But now it's more common to see dolphins, whales, and seals. The bird life is incredible. We have peregrine falcons nesting in the Brooklyn Bridge, ospreys nesting in the East River, all kinds of wading birds. All of these things are coming back to the harbor. Oh, and seahorses. Everyone likes seahorses. We know that we can do this. We know that we can restore a billion oysters to New York Harbor, and that if we do, the harbor will be a healthier, more abundant place. But ultimately, oysters alone can't save New York Harbor, because water quality in New York Harbor is the same as every single other environmental challenge, in that it's a people problem, and people need to behave differently in order to solve it. By engaging 1 million people in restoring 1 billion oysters, we're creating a constituency for the harbor. And that will be the key for changing the relationship that the city has with the natural resource, for raising the profile in the profile of the harbor in the collective consciousness of all New Yorkers, and deciding together that we can protect it. And this is what I'm here for today, to advocate for keystone species restoration in our great estuary cities. The world's great estuaries are the nursery grounds that fill the oceans with fish. Most of our great estuaries now also have giant cities on them. In fact, 22 of the largest 30 cities in the world are built on estuaries. All of them used to be incredibly abundant natural places. Most of them used to be filled with oysters before we ate them all, and all of them are filled with people who increasingly lack access to the natural world. For me, the most exciting ecosystems to restore are not way off in the wilderness or way out in the ocean. The most exciting ecosystems to restore are in downtown New Orleans, San Francisco, Seattle, Hong Kong, London, and right here in Boston. There we go. That's hard for a New Yorker to end on. Right here in Boston. Billion Oyster Project is a model that has relevance anywhere in the world that people live on or near a degraded natural system, which is everywhere in the world. We can take the lessons learned in New York City and apply them to these other great harbor cities, and if we do, we can not only restore some of the systems necessary to fill the oceans with fish, but we can make the act of restoring nature thrilling and change how hundreds of millions of people understand their relationship to the natural world and their ability and responsibility to restore it. Thank you. Thank you.